me why there's no other hound I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Tonight in this place. We thank you, oh God, for our pastor. Continue to strengthen him, Lord, and bless him. Bless our First Lady and all the sick and afflicted among us. Bless our young people, Lord. Bless each and every soul. We thank you for the victory already won in your precious name. We love you tonight because you so loved us. Bless right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Remain standing if you ever have a praise for the Lord. We want you to praise the Lord for yourself. God's been good to each and every one of us. Amen?
Amen.
You can't praise him for me, but you can praise him for yourself.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Just come.
Thank the Lord for another day. Thank you. Thank you for another blessing. Thank you for another.
Hope.
Thank you.
Get
better.
All right.
Thank you so much, Jesus. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Can we say amen?
Amen. Satisfied with Jesus. Satisfied with Jesus. Let it be my hunger. Because I know the enemy don't want me to be in the house of the Lord. All right.
Is there another praise for the Lord?
Thank you.
Is there another praise? No one else? We're not going to beg you to praise the God who saved us tonight. Let's hear from our musician, Sister Ashley. Praise the Lord.
I just thank God for another day. I thank God for answering prayers. Thank God for being able to see my mistakes and be willing to admit them and be willing to fix them.
All right.
And ready to do whatever it takes to make sure that my life lines up with God.
Amen. Is there another prayer? First Lady, Sister Hope.
Without God, we can do nothing. Without God, we can only but fail. God is merciful. I've been thinking on, as I've been speaking lately, on our political system. It's a broken system. And we've got to pray, because God's word is coming to pass. Evil men will wax worse and worse, and they're doing just that thing. We're going to ask you to turn with us as we go before the Lord to Psalm 73. It's good to see you back in the house of the Lord tonight. We would that more were here, but nevertheless, we give God glory and we give Him praise and give Him honor. Let us all stand. If you got to say amen.
Amen.
Truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart.
But as for me, my feet had almost gone, and my head was not
yet. For I was envious at the foolish, when I saw the prosperity of the wicked.
For there are no bands in their death, but their strength is
burned. They are not in trouble as other men. Neither are they plagued like other men.
There the word I confess them about as a chain. I have covered them as a garment.
Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish.
They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak lawfully.
They set their mouths against the heavens, and their tongues walk it through the earth.
Therefore, if you return hither, waters of a full cup are wrung out to them.
And they say, how does God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High?
Behold, these are the ungodly, who prosper in the world. They increase in riches.
Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain, and washed my hands in innocency.
All the day long have I been plagued patiently every morning.
If I say, I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of thy children.
When I thought to know this, it was too painful.
Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I therein.
Surely thou didst set them in slippery places. Thou cast them down into destruction.
How are they brought into desolation as in a moment? They are utterly consumed with terror.
As a dream when one awakens, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image.
Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my reins.
So foolish was I in hate of me, I was as a beast before thee.
Nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holden my hand, holden me by my hand, my right hand, excuse me.
Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory.
Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee.
My flesh is my heart's faith, but God is the strength of my heart, and my portion forever.
For lo, they that are far from thee shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a whoring from thee altogether. But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all his words. All thy works. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this hour. We thank you for your kindness in blessing us to enter into your house in this hour. Help us, Lord, that we may teach thy word and glorify thee. Bless your people, Lord, that they may receive and be exalted in thy word. Keep them, Lord, and bless them. Guide them as they go. Keep us this night, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. I like this song because it really speaks to the situation in which we find ourselves. It says, truly God is good to Israel. We can kind of put in that, truly God is good to the church.
Amen.
Come on now. Even to such as are of a clean heart. Mm-hmm. Now that means something. That's not the way we look. We look on the outward appearance. But God looks on the heart. He understands our desire. We sometimes think God is so far from us that he doesn't understand the situation in which we find ourselves. But God is always mindful of the church and of his people. His desire is to bless us and to increase us, and that we may be prosperous in the land. That is the desire of God. But we have to remember that prosperity is not necessarily salvation. It is not necessary because you have prosperity, you are right with God. Amen? That doesn't mean that God is pleased with you because you have everything that I could even look upon and desire. But God is displeased. That's what the situation that Asa found himself in. Because he was looking, as many as us do, at the prosperity of those that are around us, knowing their manner of life. We say, how are they blessed and we have nothing? Come on now. How are they exalted? In essence, Asa was doing the same thing, and he did not understand the blessings that God had bestowed upon him. It does not say that Asa went and became prosperous. But it says Asa went into the house of the Lord. And when he went into the house of the Lord, then he understood therein. Those that trust in their riches. And that's what's happening in our country today. Folks are trusting in their riches, and the church is looking at them. The church is looking at them and wondering, why isn't God blessing us that way? But if we listen, we are highly blessed. We are highly favored with God. Come on now. You're blessed to wake up this morning. I know the afflictions or the sicknesses that I have in my own body and the things I have to deal with, the pains that I have, but nevertheless, I'm thanking God for the provisions that he has made and the way that he has kept me down through the years. I am grateful to God that he has sustained me. We want to go to the Psalm again, saying Psalm, the 132nd Psalm. I want to refresh our understanding on who Jesus is. Before we go there, let's go to Genesis. The 22nd chapter. God has promised us that he would come. He promised Israel, and the promise came to us that he would deliver us. But sometimes we forget, and we get beside ourselves in thinking that we got to do this thing ourselves, and we got to depend on our own abilities. But we got to trust in God. And so God tested Abraham. Read the first verse there, Sister Hope.
It came to pass
after these things
that God did tempt Abraham.
God tested Abraham. Read. And said unto him, Abraham. And he said,
Behold, here I am.
Behold, here am I. Read.
And he said, Take now thy son,
thine only son, Isaac. Was Isaac his only son?
No.
Well, why did God say thine only son? That was the only son God promised him. He was the promised son of his wife. That was the son that God gave him. Ishmael was of the desire of the flesh. That was of the flesh. But Isaac was by promise. How do you know it was by promise? We know that Abraham was barren. How do we know that? All right. He had Ishmael. He produced Ishmael. He had been with his wife many years before he even thought about Hagar. And Sarah never had a child. Amen? Until God told Abraham, he said, this time next year, Sarah's going to bring forth. Come on now. So who did it? Abraham or God? We understand that God did it. It was not Abraham. If it was up to Abraham, Sarah would have had many children. Am I right? He was trying hard to have a son. But he was doing it of his own ability. If I would have a son today, it would be God. Amen? Ashley would have to take care of it. Lord is good. Read.
And he said,
Take now thy son. Take
now thy son.
Thy only son Isaac. Whom thou lovest.
Get thee into the land of Moriah.
And offer him there.
For a burnt offering
upon one of the mountains, which I will tell thee of. Now, that's his only son. Abraham has to have a lot of faith. At least the faith of a mustard seed. Because he told him to offer his only son, the promised son. But he had told Abraham that he was going to bless him with a son, and that son was going to bring him prosperity. Yes, ma'am. I can't.
You got
to talk toward me. You can't talk now.
What do you call when God told Abraham that Sarah was going to have a son?
What do I call it?
You don't call it the immaculate conception, do you?
No.
He impregnated her?
Yes. It's God opened the womb of Sarah. Her womb was closed. And if I may speak very plainly, the sperm did not affect Sarah's age because God wasn't ready for her to have that son. He wanted her to have it when he wanted her to have it. Amen? So it was a pregnancy that came from Abraham. But God opened the womb so that the sperm could get through. You see, there was not immaculate conception, and what we call immaculate conception, I found out that we have the wrong idea, because the Bible doesn't talk about immaculate conception. That's a Catholic word. The Bible does not talk about immaculate conception. And when you read and find out what they're talking about, they're not talking about Jesus. They're talking about Mary as being immaculate conceived. Her birth was immaculate, they're saying, which is not so. Amen? Just wanted to get that straight. Read.
Abraham rose up early in the morning.
And took two of his young men with him.
Isaac his son.
Clave the wood for the burnt offering. And rose up and went up to the place of which God had told him. In other words, Abraham believed God and he was ready to do what God told him to do, even if it was the only son he had that was promised by God. He was willing to give that son back to God. I wonder how many of us will be so willing. How many of us, if God told us to do something, will we be willing to do it? Sometimes we're not willing to do even some simple things that God asked us to do. Some of the simplest things that God can ask us to do, we draw back. We got to learn to trust in God. You talk about the faith of a mustard seed. If I had a mustard seed up in between my fingers, you couldn't see it. So our faith must be really small. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. The promised son, it will be the same thing as only begotten? Would be different
name. No, it wouldn't be that. It's a because Isaac was the only promised son.
Okay.
And Isaac Ishmael was begotten of Abraham. So was Isaac begotten of Abraham. But Isaac was promised by God. Ishmael was not. Ishmael was by the flesh. A man and a woman get together, they can produce a fetus. Amen? But if God says no, it won't happen. But God doesn't do that with everyone. He has a special purpose, and he did that with Sarah to carry out his plan of salvation. So way back here, in the beginning, God was planning on our salvation. That's what this chapter is about. Read.
Then on the third day,
Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. Read.
And Abraham said unto his young men,
Abide ye here with the ass,
and I and the lad
will go yonder
and worship
and come again to you. Now, Abraham has a lot of faith. God told him to sacrifice Isaac. But he's telling his young men that he and Isaac will return. Come on now. What? He's what? No, it's not. Did he return?
He didn't know he was
going to
return.
He had faith that he was going to return. He had faith that he was going to return. God told him to sacrifice. God gave it to him, didn't he? That's the reason that man has, which he just spoke of, that we feel that God can't do. We don't believe that God has that kind of power, really. With our tongue, we say it. But within our heart, if God asks us to do it, we're not willing to do it. We don't believe he can do it. Now, I spoke this some time ago when I was back down on Eight Mountain. Now ask one, what would you do? Would you deny God if they were going to take your baby and tie him up between two horses and say, if you don't deny Jesus, we're going to split this baby in half? What would you do? And that was their first child. They had a whole lot of doubt. Come on now. They have a, was she different from us? Were they different from us?
No.
Am I saying something strange about this one? God say that about anybody in here. But as the deacon just spoke, that is a feeling that we have within. I don't get to this point, but I want to go there now. Samuel, 1 Samuel. 16th chapter. And the 7th verse.
But the Lord
But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance,
or the height of his stature,
because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Abraham had enough faith in God. He had dealt with God long enough that he believed God. He had dealt with God long enough. And this is what it comes talking about, getting to know God. If you don't know me, you won't trust me. And sometimes when you know me, you won't trust me. If you don't know God, if you don't get to know God and know what he does, you won't trust him. And you can be puzzled as to how can Abraham believe that God is going to bring Isaac back. But he believed God. And this chapter will tell us. Read. Genesis.
And
Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac, his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife. And they went both of them together. Now, if you can picture this, the father laid the wood on the son, and they marched up the hill. Who do you see? What do you see? It's God that laid the cross on Jesus. It's God that laid the cross on Jesus. And they went up the hill together. Jesus is God. See, most folks get that mixed up when we say with him. God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. I like the question, how does Abraham know? And to say that he was lying, no, he wasn't lying. He was believing. He was believing.
Believed in what?
Believing God.
God told him to sacrifice.
Yeah.
So then how can I say the sacrifice is to kill, right?
Yes.
Okay, so if God told me to sacrifice to kill my son, how am I going to say I'm going to bring him back if God told me to kill him?
Because God promised him prosperity through Abraham, through Isaac. He's gonna bless Abraham through Isaac, not through Ishmael, but through Isaac.
Okay, then he knew God wasn't gonna kill him.
No, he don't. He don't know what God gonna do.
If
he doesn't know what.
If God knows. If God said he's gonna bless him through his lineage, through Isaac, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then God tell you to kill him. That's contradiction, right?
Is it?
Yeah.
Contradiction for who?
If you tell me, that's saying you're going to do one thing and then you say you're going to do another. That's contradiction, right?
For who?
I'm asking you. If you tell me...
No, I'm saying for who? Who are you speaking of?
Whoever.
Not for whoever. Not for God, it ain't contradiction. Mm-hmm.
In general terms, that's contradiction.
God ain't general.
I'm just speaking in general terms. If I tell you I'm going to do this, then I tell you I'm going to do that. Is that contradiction?
If you tell me, yeah.
Okay, now. So God told him he's going to do one thing, and God said he's going to do another thing. Right?
Say that again.
God said, kill your son. Then he said, I'm going to bless you through your son.
Mm-hmm.
So, how can he do both?
How can God do both?
Yeah. If you're telling me you're going to kill him,
Genesis. And the 14th verse.
18 what?
18 Genesis and the 14th verse. Read it out loud. I want you to read it.
Is anything too hard?
Read it out loud so I can hear you.
Anything too hard for the Lord, at the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life.
So what was the question? Is it too hard for God to kill him and bring him back?
No. But that ain't what God said he's going to do. He didn't say he's going to kill him and bring him back.
He told Abraham to sacrifice him.
Right.
Abraham believed God.
Believed God what?
That God was going to do what he said he's going to do. And he was going to do what God told him to do. He was going to sacrifice his son.
But when he told the men that I'll be back, it sounds like to me he was saying either he knew it was a test.
He believed God. He believed God. If God killed him, he was able to bring him back. Is that too hard for God?
That's not what I'm saying.
I'm asking you.
If God has told him, I'm going to kill your son, then I'm going to bring him back.
He don't have to tell him.
I don't think he was thinking on those terms.
He was believing God. If God told you to sacrifice your son, and that's all he told you to do, would you do it? That's the problem. That's not the, you don't know God well enough yet. Yes, ma'am. Sister Weir.
Hebrews 11:17-19.
Hebrews.
Just, yeah.
Wait a minute. What chapter?
11th chapter. I think it starts at 17th verse.
By faith, Abraham. When he was tried,
offered up Isaac. And he that had received the promises,
offered up his only begotten son,
of whom it was said,
that in Isaac
thy seed shall be called.
Accounting that God was able to raise him up.
Even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure.
Do you believe that? Do you believe that one?
I didn't believe that one.
Can you get some confidence from that one?
I have confidence. Maybe it's just not where it's supposed to be.
Could be. Let's go back to Genesis 22.
Genesis
Read.
Isaac
spake unto Abraham, his father, and said,
My father.
And he said,
Hear
am I, my son. And he said,
Behold, the fire and the wood.
This is Isaac speaking. Read.
Where is the lamb for a burnt offering?
Abraham is only believing God. See, we can only believe God if he shows us an end result. But believing God is taking him at his word and acting upon it. Trusting him to make it all right.
That's not ordinary belief.
No, did I say it was ordinary belief?
Uh-uh.
I said it's faith in God.
Right. And that's what I think you just said, the magic words when you said the end result.
I said we can't believe God
because
unless he gives us an end result.
The end result.
No, he gives us at the beginning, he tells us what the end result is going to be. He's going to tell us every step that's going to happen. That's not going to happen. And God is not going to always do that. We may want it, but God is not going to do that. You're just going to have to trust him. As Romney said, trust him. Romney says, trust him. Now you can trust him if you want, but I'm going to trust you. Maybe my faith is not where it ought to be, but I know God is able. I know God is able. And that's the point that Abraham had come to after dealing so long with God. Abraham is not over 100 years old. He's over 100 years old now. God has delivered him out of many situations. Out of many situations, God has brought Abraham. Abraham has had doubt about God in many situations. One in particular, he went into Egypt. And he told Pharaoh that Sarah was his sister. And Pharaoh took Sarah because she was a beautiful woman. The Bible calls her very fair. She was a beautiful woman. And Pharaoh took Sarah into his home and would have taken her for his wife. But God spoke to Pharaoh, not Abraham. God spake to Pharaoh and said, don't touch her. That's that man's wife. Pharaoh backed down. Abraham didn't know what God was going to do. He was just trying to save his own life. And God returned Sarah to him untouched. Do you think you have some faith in God then? Think you can find some faith in God if he does that? You think Abraham could find some faith in God? Lot, when they separated, was in trouble. Abraham got his
men together and went down and delivered Lot and those other kings. You think Abraham went without God? He had some experience with God. Excuse me. He had some experience with God.
So that belief is not something you just wake up in the morning.
I can't hear you. You're talking too low.
You know, just get baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost, and wake up the next day and say, okay, yeah, I believe, you know.
I didn't say that.
No, I'm just.
That's what I'm telling you now. Abraham had experience with God. Abraham had experience with God that he came to the point that he believed God. This is the point that God wants us to come to. Not just the faith to receive the Holy Ghost and stop there. Not just the faith that I got a dollar in my pocket, God is good to me. I got a nice new car, God is good to me. And that's as far as I trust God. God wants me to trust Him implicitly, without reservation. That's where God wants us to be. That's the point that He brought Abraham. He didn't bring Abraham to this point all of a sudden.
That's what they would call blind trust.
It wasn't even blind. He didn't saw what God could do. It wasn't blind. He saw what God could do. And when he saw what God could do, he was willing to trust Him. But we make excuses for what when we don't trust God. Not just you, I'm not picking on you. I'm picking on all of us. We make excuses for not trusting God. But we're going to get to the place, if God carry long enough, maybe we'll get to the place where we really can believe God. Our problem is trusting God. Read the Hebrews one more time. 11th chapter and the 17th verse. And listen to it carefully.
By faith, Abraham.
Read it again.
By faith, Abraham.
By faith, Abraham.
When he was tried.
When he was tried.
Offered up Isaac.
Offered up Isaac.
And he that had received the promises.
And he that had received the promises. Offered up his only begotten son,
of whom it was
said, that in Isaac
shall
thy seed be called, according, accounting, accounting. Listen, listen what the scripture is saying about Abraham. Accounting, or seeing, or believing, or realizing, he had to have some experience with God in order to believe God. And so he's had this experience with God, and he saw God was able to do what he said he's going to do. He believed God, stepped out on faith, did what God told him to do, was willing to give his son, even to death. That's what the scripture says. He accounting that God, what? Was able. Now, how did he account for that? Pardon? All the tests that he had been through, God took through. If you go back and read Genesis, God took Abraham through a lot. He was over 100 years old, or he was 100 years old, when he had Isaac. And so he knew that God, in his own accounting, God was able. See, if I go tell a man I want to buy his business, he's going to look at me and say, I don't think so. But if I prove to him I have the type of money to buy his business, the next time I come, will he have any doubt? Huh? Will he have any doubt if I told him I was going to buy something else from him? He wouldn't have any more doubt. If I proved to him that I was able to do what I said I could do, the next time I want to buy something, he said, I want you to go give me. He will count me able to do it without question. Or if somebody came and asked him, do you think he's for real? He said, man, trust him. I did. Trust him. Abraham today can say, trust him. That's where we got to get. That's where we got to get. Yes, ma'am.
Also in the chapter Hebrews, verse 6, it says, but without faith it is impossible to please him.
That's
Hebrews 11:6
says, without faith it is impossible to believe God.
To please him.
Yes, ma'am.
In the first verse right there, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for.
The evidence of things not seen. God built Abraham's faith. He's trying to build our faith. Excuse me. He's trying to build our faith. Because we have hesitation, such as you have spoken. But until we find out we can trust God, we'll always have that reservation. Just like God said, we tell folks, God's coming back again. You think everybody believes that? Not everybody in church believes it. But some are in church because they're scared. And I don't blame them. They're scared it might be true. So they've come to the house of the Lord just in case it's true. And we haven't learned to trust God. Because we won't allow the experiences that God would bring our way to happen. And so he can build our faith. Now, faith don't come overnight. Baptized in Jesus' name, and all of a sudden I'm full of faith. You got to have some experience with God. Sister Pope.
Verse 13 says, it speaks to that even if you have faith, you still might not see the end
that God promised you. Because it says these, he was talking about Noah and Abraham, these all died in faith.
Not receiving the promise.
Not having received the promise, but having seen them
afar off.
And were persuaded of them, mm-hmm. and embraced them, and confessed that
they had experience with God.
They
had experience with God and accounted that he was able. They accounted that God was able. And you can find in Peter. Might be 2 Peter, 1st chapter. I'm not going to get to where I was going tonight. But that's all right. Second Peter, and then I got maybe it's First Peter that I'm looking for. Read 1 Peter, 1st chapter, 10th verse. 1 Peter, 1st chapter, 10th verse.
Salvation.
Of which salvation?
The prophets have inquired.
And searched diligently.
Prophesied of the grace.
That should come unto you. In other words, they talked about it. They prophesied about it. But they didn't see it. Read.
Searching what or of what?
Searching of what?
Searching what or what manner of time?
What verse are you in?
11.
Searching what or what of what manner of time? The Spirit of Christ,
which was in them,
did signify. When it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ
and the glory that should follow,
unto whom it was revealed
that not unto themselves
but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. I'm just trying to show you. It's by faith. Abraham's faith was built on believing God, seeing what God is able to do. Even the little faiths, we've got to trust God. You see, what we have, we don't believe God gave it to us. Because we look around and we see somebody else without it. And you say, well, I got this. I did this. Not that God blessed me and was able to bless them. But my, Lord, have mercy. Deuteronomy 8. We talked about this last week. We dealt with this last week, but I see we come right back to it again. Read the 11th verse.
Beware.
That thou forget not the Lord thy God.
And not keeping his commandments.
And not keeping his commandments.
And his judgments.
And his statutes.
Which I
which I command thee this day.
Lest when thou hast eaten
and art full. This has been good to me tonight. For it gives us understanding, and it helps me to give the church understanding that we don't trust God yet. Not like we should. It is a blessing to trust God to the extent that we do. But God is able to do more than we're able to act, than we're able to think or ask. But we don't believe that. The children of Israel, when God, when they were in the wilderness, God had fed them with manna. Should that have built their faith? Should they trust God now? God gave them manna from on high. Should that cause them to trust God? Didn't it? They said, can God give us meat? They still, and God gave them meat. Did they trust God yet? Come on now. God opened the earth up and swallowed up thousands of them because they did not believe him. Did they trust God? What was God doing? Showing them how great he is. See, we say God is great, but we don't know how great that word great is. He's greater than we can express. He's able to do more than what we can ask for. But we don't believe God is able. We say it. From me. I don't know if it's Ezekiel, the 30th chapter, or 33rd chapter. Yes. It's also in Matthew, the 15th chapter, I believe it is, or 7:15. It says, wherefore the Lord said, for as much as this people draw near me with their mouth and with their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men. Good sayings, but they really don't believe.
The other is Matthew
15. 15 and 8.
15, 7
and 8. Read 15,
7.
Ye hypocrites. Ye hypocrites. Well did Esaias prophesy you. That's Isaiah talking about this scripture right here.
Mm-hmm.
Saying.
This people.
Draw nigh unto me.
With their mouth. And honoreth me. With their lips. But their heart. Is far from me.
Did God speak right? It's not one. It's all. If you check your own heart, many of you have the same question. Anytime a question is asked, it's just one bold enough to ask it. But everybody else got the question in their heart. Amen. They got it in their heart. Yes, ma'am.
I want to know when God shows you things that can be likened to a miracle, what still keeps you from believing?
I can't hear you real good over this fan.
Okay.
You got to talk much louder.
If God shows you things that can be likened to a miracle, I don't know if you would call it that. What would keep you from believing after he showed you again and again?
What would keep you from believing?
Yeah.
If he showed you something that is a miracle.
Something that's unexplainable.
Unexplainable. And he does it again and again. What was that part? I can't remember your words.
Why
wouldn't you believe?
But you say that you do.
Yeah.
But
after he shows you so many times, and then you still have doubt. Well, we would have to ask the children of Israel the same thing. Because God showed them miracle after miracle after miracle. And he shows us. Pardon?
We don't have to ask them.
We have to say he shows us. And we still refuse to believe God. In the Gospels, it says he could not do many miracles because of their unbelief. I believe that's in Matthew. I forget what chapter is in. I wasn't intending to go in this vein. But since I'm here, and God has led me into it, find that for me.
Matthew 13:58.
13 what?
58.
Matthew 13:58. Find it for me and read.
And he did not many mighty works there.
Start at the beginning. Let me get there. It started at 53.
And it came to pass.
When
Jesus had finished these parables.
He departed thence.
When he was coming to his own country,
he taught them in their synagogue,
insomuch
that they were astonished,
and said,
Whence hath this man this wisdom?
And these mighty works.
They couldn't believe a man could do what he said and what he was doing. Read.
Is not this the carpenter's son?
In other words, they looked at him only as a man. And that's what's wrong with us. We don't see him as God. say you can't trust in the pastor, so many people, they do it, and that's why they get mad at the pastor. When they trust in the pastor and not in God, and the pastor does something that is not in line with the way that they think, they cut him off. He becomes a man real quick. He's not their God anymore. But as long as he produces seemingly what they desire, he's all right with them. Their faith is in the man and not in the man that the preacher is preaching about. That's our mistake. Our mistake is that we look at the man and not at God. Our trust is in the man. If I tell you, God told me to sacrifice your son, you say you must be crazy. You're out your stupid mind. You better get away from me. Without a doubt, you would say that. But if God told you, what would you do? He made himself known. See, you can't do what God told you to do till you become acquainted with him. So many of us are associated. We're not acquainted. We got to learn to become acquainted.
More acquainted with the pastor than with God.
Right, because you look at, you want the pastor to do the miracles. Not God. And if the pastor don't do the miracle, you ain't nothing. All your faith is in the pastor. That's not going when he fails one little bit. Bam, you ain't nobody. Cut you off in a minute. I got to find somebody else that I can trust in. Sister Bo.
Could you elaborate on Romans 3 and...
No, I don't want to go there tonight. See, I didn't even get to where I was going tonight.
It's about the faith.
What is that?
It says, saying it is one God which shall justify the circumcision by faith and the uncircumcision through faith. What's the difference of by and through? Why are they... If it's one God, why are they stipulating?
I'll have to break the words down and bring it back another time. But right now, I understand more readily right now that our faith is not in God as it ought to be. Our faith is in flesh. Our faith is in flesh. We don't trust God as much as we say we trust God. Let me get back to Genesis right quick, because I want to finish that scripture anyway. I want to show you what Abraham did. Show you Abraham's faith. Read about the where we stopped.
And
nine.
They came to the place
which God had told him of. Abraham built an altar there.
Laid the wood in order.
And bound Isaac his son.
And
laid him on the altar upon the wood. We don't find that Isaac is complaining. We don't find Isaac complaining. Neither did we find Jesus complaining. Read.
Abraham
stretched forth his hand
and took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called on him.
In other words, he was prepared to do what God told him to do. He was prepared. And God saw he was prepared and would have done what he told him to do. Read the next verse.
The angel of the Lord
called unto him out of the heaven.
And said, Abraham.
Abraham.
And he said, Here am I.
And he
said,
Lay not thine hand upon the lad.
Neither
do
him
do anything unto him.
For now I know
that thou fearest God. And seest that thou hast not withheld thy son.
Thine only son from me.
Now, God said, he saw. God said, he saw. That he was not going to withhold his son from him. His only son. That he was going to sacrifice Isaac. That's what the scripture says. Now we believe it or we don't. That's a matter of fact. We believe that or we don't. But the Bible says, God said Abraham was about to do it. What? Not about to do it, he was going to do it. Until God stopped him. Do we believe God? This thing is about faith tonight. It's about trusting God. Where is your faith? And that's a song that James Cleveland used to sing. Where is your faith? Who do we really put our faith in? Are there any more questions? I'll deal with that by and through the next time. Yes, ma'am.
God already knew. Wasn't he just showing Abraham?
He was testing Abraham.
Right, because God knows the beginning from the end.
He wouldn't taken Abraham to that point until he had found that Abraham trusted him.
He had
done enough in Abraham's life that Abraham trusted God.
But he said, now I know.
He said, now I know.
But he already knew.
God knows all.
Right.
But he saw that it was in Abraham's heart to do his will. That's how come he could say what he said. And that's how come he could tell Abraham to take his son and to sacrifice him. Are there any other questions? We thank God. We thank God for his kindness and for his grace and his tender mercies. We're going to ask if there's anyone that may have been listening on the outside, us talking about faith, and possibly the word of God reached you and you want to be saved. Now is your time to be saved. Repent and be baptized. Turn from your sin. Turn from your sin. Trust God. Go down in the water in Jesus' name. Let him fill you with his spirit. Walk with him. Learn God. Draw nigh to God. Put your faith in God, and he will bring you through. Is there just one? Why?
Not tonight. Oh, why?
do all things. We just got to put our trust in God. We got to put our faith in God. We've got to believe the word of God. We got to believe it by faith. That's the only way we can please God, is by faith. Let us all stand as we prepare to bring offering.